You might not know the name, but you will recognise the legacy of the Sunrise School. The 1980s was a time of enormous change.
Computing was exploding. There was money to do things that looked good and sounded good.
It marked a real turning point that would change the world for the decades to come.
And it was like an answer to a prayer.
Sunrise was a pioneering program to reshape the use of computers in schools.
We'd done nothing like it before. The kids were actually coding, and they were coding to control robots.
But the road to the future is never straightforward.
There was a disconnect, I think a very serious disconnect.
And this radical program met an early demise, but it did pave the way for the world's first laptop classroom. And it probably doesn't get the recognition it deserves. By 1987, computers had been in Australian classrooms for about half a decade, but we didn't really know much about how they were being used or their impact. So the Australian Council for Education Research decided it was time to find out.
Educational technology was one of the areas that we decided we'd focus on. And among the candidates we interviewed was Liddy Neville, who was kind of out of left field.
One of my friends said to me, there's a job you need, it's at ACER. It closes today, which was a Friday. And I put a note in the mailbox saying, someone's told me this might be a job for me. I don't know what it is, but I'd like to participate.
She came with a much broader vision of what could be done than I had in mind. It was completely radical, and it was different from what I imagined when we advertised to get someone to lead the work. She'd built networks into the group at Massachusetts Institute of Technology with Seymour Papert and his team in the Media Lab.
These were the rock stars of educational computing, and they'd already set up tools to allow children to start programming. Liddy convinced ACER to explore their ideas. Somewhat unusually, this School of the Future, or Sunrise School as it would come to be known, would be hosted at the Melbourne Museum.
It seemed to me having kids in a museum would be very different from having kids in a school, and that would provide us with lots of different opportunities. What we thought was that we were going in to make a new kind of institution, and the director of the museum at the time was very broad thinking and was quite keen to help us do that.
Prentice Hill Secondary College joined in, sending some of its Year 8 students and teachers to the Sunrise School twice a week.
This is Lisa.
Thank you.
Hello, I'm Lisa.
You want to introduce me?
Oh, this is Madeline.
I'm Madeline.
This is Lisa.
Oh, hi, I'm Lisa.
You can introduce me.
Oh, this is Madeline.
Hi, Madeline.
My early memories of it were of the museum in its old location at the State Library. Yeah, I loved that.
We were in a lovely room with a dome and Farlap, but Farlap was right in the middle of everything we did.
It's so cruel, look, Farlap!
It didn't really feel like school.
No, it didn't feel,
like school at all. It's great fun going to the toilet. Because you could choose which toilet to go to, so you could go for a little wander.
Yeah, you sort of felt like you had special access to these secret parts of the museum.
We had no furniture. We did not get chairs, tables or anything. And we had kids sometimes sitting on cardboard boxes or putting computers on cardboard boxes. We didn't set anything up very well at all.
Despite the makeshift conditions, the students did get access to a range of cutting-edge technology. They had a series of Apple IIe computers, the Logo programming software that was developed in MIT, and some turtle robots and very early versions of programmable Lego. And the teachers came to the project with a fresh perspective, giving the students the freedom to explore these new technologies.
Lisa, what is this? A merry-go-round.
And you built it?
Yeah, with a group of other people.
What made you decide that you wanted to understand and learn how to work and build a merry-go-round?
We were all sitting around in a group and we'd finished a project that we were working on and we were trying to think of what we were going to do next and just thought, oh, merry-go-round.
It was, yeah, a different way of learning, and learning by doing was not theoretical.
You could get into really advanced geometry very quickly and very easily. A group of boys who really would have been much rather using their lunchtime kicking the football or the soccer ball, one of their first tasks was getting the turtle to mark out a soccer field. And that took them a long while. They were surprised how long they took, but they did get really very heavily involved in that.
It's an
nice problem for you, isn't it? You've got something there that does clever things. You're not quite sure how to get it to go, and you're not quite sure what clever things it does. Are you going to find out from somewhere, or what are you going to do about it?
Put it on the flip side.
Put it on the flip side? Okay, good idea.
With the school showing promise, Lydia decided it was time to open the doors to outsiders.
And we'd invite all these people to come along and hear about what we were doing, which was crazy and ambitious and wonderful.
I went because I received a letter saying schools aren't good places for students. Come to the museum and we'll show you how to do it. I thought, okay, I'll take the criticism. I don't understand why a museum with dead artifacts is going to be good for young people who are lively, but I'm open to it. And it was like an answer to a prayer. The idea of empowering students with their learning is what I heard in this whole process.
That was the beginning of a new partnership and would be just the first of a number of Sunrise centres that would split off from the museum project. While that was good news, some problems did start to emerge at the Sunrise School at the museum.
The work and the ideas that were being followed were ideas at the cutting edge of computer education in the world. I just wish it had been a better environment.
The new approach to learning and the freedoms afforded to some students presented a real creative catalyst, but for others it was hard to fathom, and it was an opportunity to get up to some mischief.
There were kids who were real handfuls, and we picked up two girls who had been picked up by the store detective in Myers on one occasion.
Even the students who were initially engaged began to lose interest. It turned out that driving your own learning was pretty hard work.
After a while, it became boring and it needed more guidance around where we could go with it, because our own self-directed creativity only took us so far.
I think it was kind of exploratory, and we didn't really spend time thinking about what were we setting up, what were we doing.
I was concerned about falling behind in maths. I'm making myself sound like a nerd.
I know, which sound very smart.
I wasn't. I wasn't a nerd, but I just remember sort of this growing sense of, is this really kind of worth it?
Are we falling behind?
Yeah, are we falling behind in some areas?
The students didn't want to come down to the museum, and they made that very clear.
We weren't just students, we were part of the project, and we needed to say if we weren't happy.
Even though this was a three-year project, at the end of the second year, the students had had enough, and Princess Hill pulled out of the Sunrise School project.
Which is a pity, because I think that might have been the magic year when these teachers would have put into effect what they'd now learned and would have achieved a lot. It just seemed that there was no point in hitting our heads against a brick wall. We already had incredible opportunities developing at MLC.
David Loder was interested in doing something with computers in schools, and in a girls' school in particular, and he really got quite a jump on the other schools.
I went and talked to Lydia and said, I'm interested.
So MLC picked up where Sunrise left off.
And with Lydia's help, we set up pretty much what she had done, but we invited students in Year 7 to opt in or opt out. But the success of it was apparent within weeks, and the students in the classes that opted out were upset that they weren't in the original. So it had a good beginning.
Every student would have a laptop, starting with the grade 5 class of 1990. So 10 and 11-year-old girls were walking around with laptops, even before most business people had them.
They were really breaking new ground in ways that no one in the world was doing it.
The success of the world's first laptop classroom at MLC inspired others to rethink how computers could be used in education. And the Sunrise School at the museum was the initial inspiration for all that.
I think it broke important ground at the beginning of a transformation.
It was inspired, and it was inspiring, and it was difficult.
I have really fond memories of it.
I think we demonstrated a lot to ourselves and to other people, and we opened up the conversation significantly. I think it was worthwhile in the end.
Sunrise is like the first pancake. It's never perfect. But without the first pancake, you can't have any others.